In this talk, I'll try and give a more slightly down-to-earth description of issues of actually implementing RNGs. A couple of things in the previous talk directly touched upon this particular designs which we'll be discussing here. We might find some interesting things there. Now, this is high point. All right. I'm going to start by looking at different kinds of entropy source, because obviously when you build a random number generator, you need an entropy source. And there are various ways to do it. I'm going to look at four of them. The first, what I call phase error accumulation sources, because they involve having typically a ring oscillator. So you'd have a circuit like that with an odd number of inverters. And as time progresses, this will oscillate. And as time progresses, the phase of that oscillation will vary given noise in the circuit that implements it. So if you sample it, you'll see a time-varying signal going 1010. But if you undersample it, if you sample it now and then wait a while and sample it again, you'll find that that looks more and more random the larger the time separation between each sample. But what's the min entropy in that? And Joshua Hill at ICMC 2015 published it's more of a procedure for determining the min entropy, but it's because it's described in terms of a test, but it's actually, I'm sure you can get to a closed form equation if you wanted to. But this is describing, it describes a test where you measure the, you split the period into a set of bins and measure a number of samples and put the samples into the bins based on their time delta from a reference frequency, and then do this sum over them and you get a min entropy calculation. If you were to do that from a model, you would be able to define, that was based on a worst case noise assumption, you'd be able to define the min entropy. There are problems with this. Down the bottom, I said they're typically attackable. Number 12 there is a paper where they simply do simple frequency injection on the power supply and cause these oscillators to lock nicely. There's another thing people do, a number of chips I'm aware of, where they take these ring oscillators and they'll create multiple of them. And they thought, well, this is nice, so I'll have multiple ring oscillators and I'll XOR the output together. That'll be great. It'll be more random. And because these oscillators are a different size, a different frequency, they won't interact. This is about the worst thing you can do because, A, they will lock. Anybody who's familiar with anyone who plays guitar, for instance, I do that, and you play a note and you leave the other strings to jangle, they will, right? Whether or not they have a common frequency, they're going to find some way to pick up that harmonic or some harmonic in common. Even if it's not an exact integer multiple. And that's exactly what circuits do, and there are various reasons for that. If I imagine I have two ring oscillators and they happen to lock in a certain way, then I XOR the output. More canceling will happen than addition. That's a common problem, and that's one of the mechanisms that in both those papers I reference. That they get the output of output of ring oscillator systems to look non-random. So this is a way to do it. It can work with a following wind and some heavy-duty engineering, but it's a very difficult thing to get right, and there's plenty of examples of it not being done correctly. This is an interesting design. It was published fairly recently in the past 2 or 3 years. Called the modular entropy multiplier. Somebody else called it an infinite noise multiplier. And it's essentially a successive approximation DAC, and what you do, digital analog converter. And what you do with one of those is you take some reference voltage in the middle of the range and of the voltage you're trying to measure, and you say, is it above it? Oh, I'll output a 1. Or if it's below, I'll output a 0. Then you subtract that reference voltage, multiply the voltage by 2 and do it again, and you repeat, and you end up outputting a series of, you know, of bits representing the amplitude of the signal. Typically, this is called a successive approximation DAC. typically you go down to about 6 or 7 bits on that kind of DAC. They're not very accurate because the noise prevents any smaller bits being representative of the data. But that's exactly what we want in an entropy source. So instead, if you just keep running one of these things, you'll get random bits coming out. So what this is describing there is the next voltage is 2 times the either the last voltage or the last voltage minus the reference voltage, based on whether or not the reference voltage, the last voltage was less or greater than or less than a reference voltage. And then the output value is just the Boolean result of the comparison. So what we end up doing is taking some slightly noisy signal, because you're in an electronic circuit, multiplying it. If it's too big, you make it smaller, multiply it, and so on, and repeat, and you get data out. Now, this is completely useless on silicon, on chips, because it requires a kind of linearity in the mathematics. But you can build it in a board design. That particular thing there, you can buy. It's got 3 op amps and a USB chip, and you can do linear circuits on the board level. So this is good for board level type designs. If you were paranoid and you wanted your own entropy source, you might buy one of these and mix that into your other sources. Complexity sources. Now, we just heard about the Linux kernel, and this is an example of a complexity source where they say, well, we have all these interrupts, and we'll sample the timing of the interrupts, and well, gee, there's a lot going on that leads to these interrupts, and maybe there's some entropy in them. And a thing that we saw at Intel was this move towards rack mount or blade servers running in VMs with quantized interrupt timing as a particular type of attack mitigation. No, there's an SSD, there's no keyboard, there's no mouse. So all the sources of entropy into this complex system were disappearing, but it still looked random because it was complex. But it's a low entropy system, so if you were to run it multiple times, you might find there's some correlation between the sequences you get out. So I think a simple example that's illustrative of this would be, let's imagine we lived in a deterministic universe. Quantum physics wasn't random, it was just pseudo-random. Your lava lamp, each time you restarted the universe, would do the same thing time and again. But in general, it would have this pseudo-random property over time. There's a nice informal notion called squish that I've seen used in various places to describe these things, and describes squish as not guaranteed to be predictable, or like, it should be neither guaranteed to be predictable nor unpredictable. It's but it is what is used, has been used in operating systems a lot. And you can think, well, why? Why do that? Why not take an entropy source and put an extractor and put a PRNG? And the answer is, operating systems are software. They don't have entropy sources. They've got to make do with what's provided. So it's not a very satisfactory way to build an RNG, place to build an RNG. They don't have the tools available to them in the form of entropy sources or knowledge of the entropy sources properties. Metastable phase collapse sources. These are great. So this is from a Samsung paper. I built one of these in ACT logic, and it didn't work. I built one in silicon, and it did. What's going on here, when this multiplexer, or these multiplexers here, are held in one state, there will be a loop going around here and going around here like this. And this one will be a loop. And this one will be a loop. And in fact, you will have multiple of these loops. And these inverters are, in fact, inverter chains, just like we saw in the ring oscillator. They are it's a set of ring oscillators. And you can hold this wire in some value, and they will all oscillate, hopefully independently. And then when you change it to the other value, the multiplexer, now it becomes a big loop, just all the way like this. So you switch it back and forth between being lots of little loops and one big loop. Maybe I'll draw on the whiteboard to explain. If we have, okay. you think of an oscillator as a ring oscillator as a series of inverters. So there's an inverter represented by a line because it's quicker to draw. And they have a state. They're 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1. And that's stable, right? Inverting. But if I have an odd number, now this is this 1 or 0? I don't know. But what you know is that because there is an odd number, there is some discontinuity here, that there's some state which ultimately will be transitioning between a 1 and a 0 because the input is the wrong way, the other way around. And as it changes, this one will change. And then so there will be this transitional state that's moving around. That's the that's how a ring oscillator works. But I set each of these into their own little ring oscillator. And then I switch them into one big ring. So imagine these are now it's its own chain of inverters oscillating. So when I do that switch, I might find I've got multiple points where there's one of these discontinuities. And that's not a stable system. That is a metastable system. And these things will collapse into one big ring where there's only one point running. So this is a way of building a metastable metastable system. And the resulting phase of the circuit contains some entropy resulting from the noise that drove the metastable circuit. My slides have disappeared. All right, there we go. So, yep. Metastable. All right. So that thing there is a flip-flop. It stores one bit of information. It's got a data coming in, and it's got a clock coming in. When there's an edge on the clock goes from 0 to 1. It will sample the value there and put it there and keep it until the next time you have an edge on the clock. Now, what if the time that this transitions, this is also transitioning at exactly the same time? What will happen is maybe it will take the value that was before the transition, maybe it'll take the value it was after. We don't know because it's right on the edge. And in fact, what can happen is that circuit can land right on the edge, and it'll take some time to decide whether to be one or the other. Now, the human analogy is you meet somebody in a corridor going the other way, and you're going to pass each other. But sometimes you both step the same direction, and you go, oh. and it takes a little time to resolve. In fact, it takes exponential time. It's the chances of it resolving increases exponentially with time. So this is a standard problem in electronics. It's called metastability, that when you sample an asynchronous signal, you don't know that it's stable at that point, and you might end up in one of these metastable situations. Noise tends to be noise is the thing that drives metastability into resolution. So that's why we build entropy sources using metastable techniques, because it's a way of sensing noise. So that's what we're going to talk about now. So good question. So here's a model of a metastable source. So this represents the state of an electronic circuit. And it's a ball, and it's going to drop on this hill. This represents a transfer function of a circuit. Now, that because we built that out of atoms, it's not necessarily going to be positioned there. This hill could be over there. The hill could be over here. And that variation we can characterize as having standard deviation. The position across a population of devices will be normal. And so we can fully describe the variation on that like that. But think of it as a static variation. If you build a chip and you build a circuit, it will land somewhere, but it'll stay there. It's the result of the varying number of dopant atoms in the substrate of the gates of the transistors and fun things like that. This guy is the circuit, but it has noise from the environment running on it, the noise from the thermal noise in the transistors and electrical noise on the power supply. So that's your dynamic noise. So you've got this ball that's like to run left, jiggling left and right, and you're going to drop it on this hill, which may be over here. So if the hill is here, this ball is going to drop there and stay on that side. If it's over there, the ball's going to drop here and stay to the left of the hill. If they're both nicely aligned, the ball will land on the top, and rather than staying on the top, it's going to roll down one side or the other, and the noise will dictate which side it is. So if you want a random number generator, you would like the noise, this is noise, this M for manufacturing noise, because it's the statically manufactured variation of the circuit. You'd like that noise to be much bigger than that. And the answer, how much bigger? Well, about 10 is a good number. If you're building a PUF, physically inclinable function, what you want is something which is going to resolve to the same state every time you turn it on. But if you build it, build another one, it might resolve to a different state. You don't know, when you build it, you don't know what state it's going to resolve to. But every time you build it, you turn on one you've built, it'll always yield the same value. So that's a physically inclinable function. And for that, you would like the system noise to be much less than the manufacturing noise. You'd like this hill to be sufficiently far from the center that this noise can't cause it to land on the other side of the hill. So this is actually a pretty accurate model of how an electrical circuit works, where you've got a pair of inverters fighting each other to be in a 1-0 or a 0-1 state. And if you force them both to be in the same state, you end up with a metastable resolution happening, which the mathematics of dropping a ball on a hill are the same. So this is an example of a random number generator that we have built. It is not the one you'll find in your CPU. It's a bit newer than that. And here is our pair of inverters. So I talked about a flip-flop that stores a value. That thing, you can see, this takes this inverts the digital value here and puts it here. The digital value here gets inverted and put here. So this is stable. This node and this node together either want to be 1-0 or 0-1. Those pairs of values are stable values. But if we wire both sides high with a big transistor, then we can set it to 1-1. And that's not a stable state. Then we turn off these transistors, and it tries to resolve to either 1-0 or 0-1. And the electrical noise is what drives it. Now there's a problem. I talked about, if I go back, we want this to be the case. We want the manufacturing noise to be much smaller than the dynamic noise on the circuit. That's not the case. That the truth lies halfway in between these two. There we go. Lies halfway in between these two truths. Manufacturing variation is not big enough to form a PUF, and it's not small enough to create an RNG without doing other things. And so what do? We try and balance this circuit. And two tricks we pull in this circuit is these two transistors that we use to pull the circuit high. When we then release the transistors, turn them off so this circuit can resolve, we can insert a little bit of delay. We release one before we release the other. And that's a static configuration. And we, well, it's the dynamic configuration. So we look at the bias coming out, say, oh, this is too biased this way. We'll tweak these delay values to bias it the other way. Similarly, there are these two conf2s here, conf2 and conf3. We don't show the circuit because it'll fill the screen, but this is making this, as this increases, this gate gets weaker and vice versa. So the unbalancing is one of these gates is weaker than the other because you just built two of them and there's some variation. So again, you're trying to balance the relative strength so that what this is doing is pulling the hill into the middle. The manufacturing variation is being compensated for. So now, sigma n, the system noise, which is a function of the temperature of the chip mostly, is going to be bigger than is going to straddle the hill that we've created by building these two flops. So that's now one of the nice properties here is if I try to attack this, I can inject power supply noise, I can fire RF energy at it, I can whack it with lasers, whatever I choose to do. It's very hard to introduce a noise which can controllably tell this which way to flop. One of the things you can do, if you can overload, if you can break one of these or the other, then you'll succeed. But you know, with the circuit operating dynamically, it's going to compensate for your attempts to unbias it. No, no. The calibration depends on the data that's coming out. It's counting the 1-0 bias of the data coming out, and over time of a window, and saying, oh, in the last 10 bits you had more ones than zeros, so I'll push it this way. Yeah. Yeah. So if you had a noiseless system, which you won't have because of physics, what you would get is 1-0, 1-0, 1-0. Because it would say, oh, you had a 1, I'll push it towards a 0, and you get a 0. Now you've got a 0, I'll push it towards getting 1, I'll get a 1. But the noise will overcome that. So it says it, in this circuit, sigma n is much greater than sigma n because the calibration network minimizes sigma n. On a physically unclonable function, a puff is going to look much simpler. Where's my dot? There's my dot. You'd build it something like that. Now, again, you'd need transistors to set it into an unstable state. But So the stable state is off, right? You power the circuit and see what it powers up to. So in fact, you have a controllable transistor on the power supply, and you just turn it off and turn it on again to evaluate it. But you don't want to do anything to minimize sigma n. In fact, what you want to do is maximize sigma n and minimize the noise. So we have try to have a fairly noiseless circuit, and by putting a stable power supply on it. But then we try to make sure there are no systemic biases in this. So you might read out the signal. You take a buffer here and send that signal off to the rest of the chip to be used. That's a problem, because now you're putting an asymmetric load on the circuit. So we'll have a buffer here there as well. But buffers aren't perfectly transparent. So in fact, you'll have a chain of 3 buffers on either side to perfectly balance the load. So that load isn't creating fixed offset. You want the variation in the transistors in these gates to be maximized. If you start adding in other sources of variation, the central limit theorem comes into place, and everything moves to the middle, and it's not good. All right, so what is in your CPU is this. This is a similar idea to the one I just showed you. So there's your inverter. In this case, we're pulling it down. We're pulling it to 0, 0 with these transistors. But what's happening? So they resolve. These inverters here, they're called high skew. So you're putting in a voltage 0 and they put out a 1, or a 1 and they put out a 0. But the threshold is not right in the middle. It's high. And so these guys, when they're in their metastable state, the voltage is somewhere in the middle. When they resolve to 1, 0, or 0, 1, then one or other of these will cross the threshold. So while it's 1, 1 here, while it's metastable, this is 1, 1. When it's resolved, it's 0, 1, or 1, 0. From that, we can make a clock, and we can take the data. When we get the resolution, we fire a 1 shot, which makes a delay, saying, hey, we've resolved. And if we got a 1, it will go and put some charge onto here and pull by asserting that transistor and pulling some charge off this capacitor here. So these two capacitors, they're in fact the largest component in this design by a large margin. They store some electrical charge. And when we get a 1, we put some charge on this and take it off this. When we get to zero, we put some charge on this and take it off this. And this capacitor is loading either side of this network. So the difference in the charge is the balancing function that's in the calibration loop. So the difference here is essentially this is an analog type feedback. Now this actually works better than the one I described earlier, partly because the feedback is in smaller steps and it works much quicker. But if you look at the loop, the active resolving, there's a delay, it causes the clock to fire to restart the cycle, and we've got this loop going round and round. I said the resolution time of a metastable latch was exponential. So how fast does this loop go? Well, in Ivy Bridge, which was the first CPU, Intel CPU that had this in it, it's about 2.5 gigabits per second, 2.5 gigacycles per second. And it produces a bit per cycle. At around 0.9 bits min entropy per bit. So that's quite a lot of entropy over time, right? But the actual cycle of each bit is very jittery because we've got this essentially a random exponential variable inserted into the loop time of the circuit. So we're getting this jittery data out, but it's random looking. So we have what I just described as a couple of stepped update metastable sources where we're looking at the output, we're stepping the bias and repeating. And you can build a Markov model of this and say, well, what's the most likely value? And the most likely value is 101010 or 010101. And in fact, if there's a center point and you've got these steps which are trying to keep it on the center point, it's 101010 if that center point is in the middle of a step, but maybe it isn't. And so 1100 is equally likely. When you work out the min entropy of those by computing the Markov sum, you get the same value. That's the CDF. Phi there is the CDF of the transfer function. VS is the step size. And 2 is a number, right? That gives you the equation for the min entropy of one of these sources. And math says it's that, and when we build them, we find it to be true. Well, how good do these things work? What you've got is a biased source, a biased pair of flops, and we're unbiasing them by putting feedback on it. So if you've had lots of ones in the past, you're more likely to have a zero, and vice versa. So you've got negative serial correlation. So that feedback network is converting bias to correlation. And if you look at, this is some data from a chip. This is the entropy quality measured by the SP100-90B Markov-Renier-Min entropy estimate algorithm over, I think, 1,000 chips. And you'll see there's not much in it with different voltages. That's not a statistically different. This is the range of values we got at low temperature, minus 20 degrees C. This is the range of values we got at high temperature at 120. This is voltage from 0.7, 0.9, 1.1 volts. If we went up to there, the chip would start smoking. And if we went down to there, it would stop working. So this is kind of the operational range plus a bit. And you see no statistical difference between the measured entropy quality. But if we look at the serial correlation in the data, there's a very clear correlation between the serial correlation and the min entropy. As you increase the step size, the serial correlation increases. So if we go back, you look at that equation, it gets worse as the step size increases. So you want a smaller step size in your feedback network as you can get away with. If you get too small, some other things start to dominate, like your leakage on the capacitors, things like that. So lesson here is what's causing the randomness to be less than perfect, and it's the serial correlation. and that the balancing network is converting bias to serial correlation. And the way to understand the quality of the design is how to minimize that SCC. I said puffs look more or less the same. They're just a random number generator with a without a biasing network. So what we're interested in is how many of those puffs are stable, how many of them have been built so that the source is, the ball's going to drop on the same side every time. And you can do a, there's the expression in R for computing this. And you can see that if we have an array of cells, puff cells, say 1,000 of them, and we have 30% of them might be unstable. When you read them multiple times, you might get a different value. And you want to have fewer errors where you get a variation, where you have a, how many errors do you need such that less than 1 in 10 to the 9 devices exceed that many errors? Then the answer here, 30% errors, billion parts, 397 in your array of puff cells. If you're correcting for 309 that have 30% error probability, if you're correcting for 397 bits, you're going to have one failure of too many varying bits in a billion. Now, that's a bit, in reality, that's a very high number, and that's a low number. I'd be looking here for reliability numbers, partly because there are other things that hurt your reliability, so you want to be over-engineer it a bit on that. So let's look at these entropy sums. If you say I need to correct 397 bits, let's say you're using BCH, you're going to have more check bits than the plain text puff. We looked at the entropy loss calculations of, conditional entropy. We've got a puff, but we've revealed some of the data through the error correction public values. There's no entropy left. So the equation says it's negative, but it's really zero, right? So, we need these, we need more cells. So let's build 2048. Well, we can't build 2048 usefully because BCH doesn't take that number in. So 2040 fits into the evenly divided number of blocks of BCH to work on. We're going to eliminate some of these. This is the thing called dark bit, where you evaluate it multiple times. If you see a variation, you essentially perform erasure coding on that on those bits, and you throw them out, and you set them to zero. And this is better than having an unknown value on an unreliable bit. If you've got a clearly unreliable bit, each time you turn it on, if it's unreliable, you can detect that and eliminate a large portion of the unreliable bits that land in the middle. It's the ones that evade this dark bit test, but still aren't reliable that will sneak through, and you need to correct for those. So we've got 2040 cells. We've lost 20% of them to dark bit loss. We get 1632. Let's say we've got 0.9 min entropy per cell of the remaining cells. So 1468 bits of entropy. We do BCH, 1032 public fuses. So we subtract that. We get 436 bits of entropy. Then we extract using CBC MAC. The entropy extraction ratio to get a 256-bit key is now 1.7. We got 436 bits down to 256. The NIST spec says you need twice as much entropy in as you get data out. And look, we're violating that ratio. So we're still not there. We need either more reliable bits, so we have less fuse bits, or pull some other trick. So the engineering that goes into making a puff cell is all into reducing this value here, preferably down to about 1% error rate. And then you can have few enough fuses storing BCH error correction data that you don't lose all the entropy, and you've got enough left over to extract a key without too much entropy loss. Yep.
So what you call fuses are variable check bits?
Yes, yes. All right, so on the chip you have fuses. When you build the chip, you read the puff array for the first time, and you say, right, that's my golden value. I will form a, you know, compute the syndrome and do the BCH thing for that value. Yes, right. You store that public string in the fuses. We call it public because it's easy to read fuses with a microscope. So if it's your chip and the lid is on, it's not public, but that's not how we do the calculation.
And the second question is, where is this SP800-90B says you need, why do you need twice the entropy? I mean, extractive theory never said twice. Extractive theory said...
Yes. Yeah. The spec says that. That doesn't mean it makes sense. I don't know what was going through their head at the time. We commented on this. If you look in the NIST archives, you'll find our comments, my comments on that value. It says you need twice the entropy in as the length of the data out of your extractor. This includes a DODIS-esque CBC MAC extractor, right? That's one of the options. That's in there because I told them to put it in there. But this is a draft spec. But you can actually do the entropy sum correctly, as was described earlier this week. But the NIST spec says 2x, the way it is. So that's puffs. All right.
One more question. Are your errors in any way bursty? Because you don't have to use BCH. You don't have to use binary error correcting codes. If you've got bursty errors, you can use higher alphabet error correcting codes.
They are very well, the individual bits are independent to a high degree, just because they're physically separate. All right, so if we're building random number generators, we had a discussion earlier in the week where we were saying, well, you've got a seeded extractor. Where does the seed come from? And if you've already got the seed, why do you need an extractor? In an academic setting, that's an interesting discussion. In a practical setting where you've got to build a chip, it's just a fact of life. So either you have a single input extractor, which doesn't make use of a seed in the sense that we usually think of it, or we have a multiple input extractor. And so in this kind of extractor, we end up with, actually here and here, computational bounds on the adversary. In this kind of extractor, we end up with epsilon close to uniform. Hopefully, epsilon is small. Those are what we build. We don't build other types because we can't. So let's say we've got a random number generator and we're trying to test the thing to see if it's working during the operation of the circuit. Now you can take data and look at it and say, does it look random? You can do distinguishability tests. You can do compute min entropy metrics. You can do various things to statistically analyze data. But that usually takes a lot of data to get a good enough p-value. And it usually involves making some assumptions about the source that it's not cheating. It's not an output of a PRNG, for instance. Here, we know something about the source because we built the thing. It's our entropy source, and we're looking at it. You can't test for randomness in a small circuit on a chip, but you can test for failure modes. So all these patterns are equally likely in a truly random data sequence. But these patterns, all zeros, all ones, or high serial correlation, high negative serial correlation, these are characteristic of failure modes of the entropy source. So simple principle here is you can't test for random. You can test for, are we broken? And that's what we do. So the standard thing to do is you do what's called an SPOF and a DPOF analysis, single point of failure, double point of failure, try all the possible failures that could happen with one or two errors in the circuit by breaking a wire or forcing a wire high or low as if the circuit had not been built correctly, and see what the data comes out at. And the answer is, it always comes out looking like this. This covers all these tests. So the tests we actually do on Intel chips is over a bundle of 256 bits coming out of the entropy source, we count the frequency of these patterns on a sliding window. So the data serially shifts by, and we match these patterns and we count them. When we see a match of this pattern, we expect about half of them to be one. We're looking for 127.5 plus or minus some number determined by a binomial curve. And for the larger patterns, the frequencies are less. Frequencies are lower, right? So this is a count out of 256. Actually, it's a count out of 256 minus 4 here, because over 256 you don't get, you've got the end effect. So where do we get these numbers from? It is the cutoff points on the binomial curve necessary to get a 1% false positive error rate on a functioning entropy source. So that's a quite high false positive error rate. If you look at the tests in SP800-90B, the NIST spec that we're nominally working to, it describes some of its own tests, which are not good tests. They have a false positive error rate of 1 in 2 to the minus 40. Now, there's a trade-off here, false positive and false negative. The more, if you've got the test and you tweak it to have a lower false positive error rate, it's going to have a higher false negative rate, where you're going to let through bad data. False positive rate, you're detecting good data and claiming it's bad at a higher rate. So there's this trade-off. What you actually want is to detect with a very... you don't want to let through unhealthy data from a broken entropy source and call it good. That's not the conservative way. But so you want to take a healthy entropy source and maybe be a bit conservative and suspicious of it. And so 1 in 100 samples on average will be tagged as unhealthy by this test. So this is a count over 256 bits. Right? So it's cheap. Shift registers, 6 comparators, and 6 counters. This happens to spot all repeating patterns up to 6 bits in length. It detects bias and correlation up to some level that you can determine. The test, if you've got stationary data, if the statistics of the entropy source is stationary, which mostly is, then this test is highly bimodal. They'll either all fail or all pass. And as you crank the entropy up by reducing the step size, you will go to all passing to all failing to all passing. So it's quite nice, because the value you get out as you sample a number of samples is either goes to all pass or all fail. So you can put the dividing line in the middle and have a clear division of from broken to not broken. We keep a history of the last 256 samples of where each sample is 256 bits. So 64 kilobits of data. We have a history, there's a 1% false positive rate, but we expect that history to have a lot of those fails in it to conclude it's broken. What does this achieve? Let's say we've got a healthy entropy source. This is H for healthy, U for unhealthy. And imagine this is 256. I couldn't fit 256 on the screen, so I made it less. But you'll have the old false positive, right? We're trying to determine that this entropy is broken, but it's not. And we've got a false positive error here. But in the history, we see, much more than half of them are healthy. So we're good. With a marginal entropy source, maybe we'll see lots of unhealthy ones, because the entropy quality is bad. It's still running. But we might see the occasional healthy one. This is a false negative error rate. Or no, these could be correct, actually. But we're on the margin. But we're gonna say this is broken, because the majority of the values are unhealthy. But let's say we have a healthy entropy source and it breaks here. Somebody puts the voltage up too high and the transistor pops. Then we'll go from here to here, and we will fail at that point. So how can we make use of that? So I was having lunch with Margaret Salter, who's the head of cryptography at the NSA, one day. And I don't normally do that, don't worry. But her comment was, never throw away entropy. So my response was, well, instead of just taking a bunch of samples and running it through CBC Mac, because the leftover hash lemma and that paper by Dodis and friends said it works. Take the last output from the extractor and also include that in the Mac. So now we've got a structure that looks like a pool, right? We've got a value, we extract a bunch of entropy into it, but we also stir that in. How many of these values do we put in? And the answer is we put in all the healthy samples and we count them, and we require a number of healthy samples to be in the extractor. So 4, say, to get one value out. But any unhealthy ones, any ones who have been tagged by this false positive error, we are going to treat, we're just going to mix them in but not count them. We won't throw away the entropy, but we won't count it. So we look back here. In this situation, we're stirring. Oh, count up to 1, 2, 3. The next healthy one comes along, we would have a full seed if we hadn't already declared the thing to be broken because there's too many errors here. Here, we would maybe go in 1, 2, 3, 4. Here's a new seed. 1, 2, 3, 4. Here's a new seed. 1, 2, 3. Don't count this one. 4. And we've mixed in 5 values. So as the entropy quality reduces, we end up mixing in more data to each seed. So you've got a kind of adaptive response to if the entropy is getting a bit worse. We start stirring in more data. But if it breaks, our little count in the extractor is saying, oh, I've got 1, 2, 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, 3. I never get to 4 because the thing broke. Right, so I never emit another seed immediately on the break. I don't have to wait for a history of 256 values to update to decide that it's broken. I immediately stop issuing seeds downstream. So what we've got is a nice situation where we have based on a long history of data, we can decide whether or not the thing is broken. But on the short history of the last sample, we can have an instantaneous response to an entropy source breaking. So that's the basic idea of the extractor structure in the Intel RNG. So you might say, oh, well, you know, variable length fields and CBC Mac have a variable length. That's a bit suspect from a crypto point of view. Yes, but it's fine in an extractor. And there's a paper by Seth Terashima and Tom Shrimpton which says why. If you look at this, how fast is the entropy source? Well, I said 2.5 gigabits per second. In some server hardware, it's up to 5 gigabits a second. If we just let it run as fast as possible in current generation 10 nanometer silicon, it would be about 10 gig, but the circuit would burn up quite quickly. So we actually have to slow the thing down. And we try and aim at about 3 gigabits per second in new products. Otherwise, the reliability of the circuit's too low. So 312 megabytes up to 625 megabytes a second. Extractor ratio is 4. The output size is 256 for the extractor. The AES that's doing the CBC Mac is running in parallel with the data collection, so you don't have to include the time of that. So the reseed time is about 0.4 microseconds. And the maximum reseed rate in the system, because you do some other things other than reseeding, like generating data and outputting it, is max is out at about 1 million reseeds a second, but that's an artificial situation. If you're using the thing, it's probably closer to 250,000 reseeds a second. So we talked about Windows updating its RNG every few hours or days. Here we do it before you've had a chance to use it, right? So, and this is a simple defense against various kinds of things that can go wrong. Gives you forward secrecy. The algorithm gives you reverse secrecy, the CTRD-OBG algorithm. Let's look at another thing, the need for speed. Why do we need it to be so fast? So the read-rand instruction, this is the one that has the output of the CTRD-OBG. This is a spec. Who knows what the CTRD-OBG looks like? All right, on hand. All right, I'll describe it. I've got a variable V and I've got a variable K. These are, for the sake of argument, 128-bit numbers. It's the key vector. And we know what CTR mode is. You take your vector and you encrypt it, and you get a value, and you take V plus 1, and you encrypt it, and you get another value, and you proceed accordingly. V plus 2. And you've got this property that, now this in a CTR mode, these values A, B, and C look random, but not completely random, because A doesn't equal B, and B doesn't equal C, and A doesn't equal C. They're all different, because the block cipher is a bijective mapping. So what the CTR DRBG algorithm says is, you compute in one kind of invocation, you compute three values. This is the state of your system. You compute these three values. You take this value and send it out as the random number. You take this value. You XOR it with K. And that becomes the next key. And you take this value, whoops, and you XOR it with V, and it becomes the next V. So these go back into the state of the system. So you're generating and using CTR mode to generate the next value and some more random values that you use to update V and K. So now, when you get successive random numbers out, this property is no longer true, that you can have repetitions at the rate you would expect in random data. Yep.
So you're only actually using things in counter mode for three steps of the counter.
Yes, for this discussion.
Okay.
Right.
And that means you're rekeying the block cipher.
Yes. So the AES block in the Intel RNG, which I designed it, has an inline key schedule. Present the data and the key, and it computes the key schedule on the fly in hardware because you expect it to be updated frequently.
Okay, so this is not, you're saying this is not costing, rekeying is not costing you much?
No, no, rekeying, the hardware is there to rekey at the same rate as you compute the round function. And in general, I think this is a good thing. If you're using modes of operation, rekeying is great for other reasons. Rekeying frequently is great because of side channel reasons, because of attacks against key schedules. There are all sorts of good reasons to rekey often, like voting, vote early, vote often, rekey early, rekey often. But this DRBG, this is one of the nice properties that we liked and one of the reasons we picked this. When we looked at the options, and we said, well, the dual EC, we're not going to do that. There's this paper by Ferguson, and it's horrible. The hash DRBGs and the HMAC, they are a lot less efficient. You do a lot more work in a hash than you do in AES. So AES, we can be several times faster. The algorithm kind of makes sense. Now, what I didn't say was, in fact, what you're required to do is use the last two of your CTR. You can, in fact, produce several values out. So I could have V through to V plus 8, say, producing output, and then have an update. So V plus 9 and V plus 10 would go to the new key and the new vector. The spec allows this. This is higher performance, because it's one AES per operation. But then you've got this none of these values will be the same. 128 bit values. So they're not going to be the same anyway, right? So you can get away with it, but it's nice just to use the one. What happens in the server hardware, which is a lot faster, because we've got multiple AES units in it, because the performance requirements are higher, this will happen dynamically. So if you're reading at a normal rate, you'll get this with just one AES and an update, one AES and an update. But if you're trying to pull at multiple gigabytes a second, you will find that it starts doing a bit of this to keep up the speed. All right, so what needs that speed? It's written here. The set of applications where a low speed RNG is fine, by low speed I mean less than a megabyte a second, is all applications except TLS network concentrators. We looked at all the applications, all the operating systems, all the tools that are using random numbers, and the ones that need a high rate of entropy or random numbers is TLS network concentrators. Per packet nonces, session establishment, and they're doing it all the time because you say you're Google and you've got all these SSL TLS connections coming in, and they have hardware which terminates the SSL and does the crypto very fast and then passes on the plain text session to the web server, which does its thing behind this network concentrator. So these are the guys. If I take a rack full of hardware doing this, adding the read-rand instruction into the CPUs makes that thing run 10% faster for tiny sliver of extra silicon compared to all these big caches and CPUs and heat sinks and things. You can make it 10% faster with 1,000 square microns of silicon on each chip doing random number generators. So the other need for speed here, the published attacks that work against read-rand, there aren't any. Now, in the last session, we mentioned the optically stealthant dopant attack. Unfortunately, it doesn't work. And there was a paper published that after that, and I forget who did it, but they said pointed out, well, actually, it's not optically stealthy. You can see it. And the other is, we have the opposite problem. You can't just build a chip. If you've noticed, a chip factory is kind of big. There are reasons for that. The net lists are not simple. You can't just move a wire. The remaking masks is one of the bigger problems in chip design. The wires are much less than, and the features on the chip are much less than the wavelength you use to image them. So if you think about refraction of light, you would put light through a mask and then it would diffract and you'd get this funny pattern. You can do that in reverse. Right? What pattern would diffract and combine to create a sub-wavelength pattern? And that's how chips are built, to image at sub-wavelength levels. And so the largest amount of, other than protein folding, the other largest consumption of compute power in this world is computing masks for chips. And what it's doing is computing these diffraction patterns in reverse. So you want to move a wire, you're going to have a whole organization come and move that wire for you. When we looked at that paper, we said, well, sorry, many people will know you're pulling off this attack because many people are involved in doing that, would be involved in making it work. The opposite problem is we're trying to get a secret change into the chip. The opposite problem is how do we keep a secret in the chip? Let's say you've got a key in the chip. You've got many people who see that key, who are involved in making the masks and other things, and that's what we need physically unclonable functions for, because keeping a secret in a chip is hard. Putting a secret change in a chip is difficult. But if we look at read seed, now this is the DRBG output from SP800-90A, according to that algorithm I described over there. This, in ENRBG, they changed the name. I think it's now just an NRBG in the latest draft. But enhanced non-deterministic random bit generator. This structure, you take an output from read-rand, from the DRBG. You take an output from your extractor. You XOR them together and send it out the door. So this is nominally a full entropy value. It's the output of an extractor with some other stuff mixed in. As a result, it's a lot slower than read-rand. So when you try and use read-rand, you'll find the throughput is, while this might be 2 gigabytes a second on your server chip, this might be 40 megabytes a second. So there was a paper published about 2 weeks ago, covert channels through random number generator, where they're actually they're saturating the use of this on one core, and it becomes, that saturation becomes visible to another core running in a different VM or a different context. And it can be used as a covert channel. You then modulate your saturation of the channel. It's not the only covert channel. There are lots of covert channels through cache timing and other things like that. So this is just another one. But the difference is we deliberately designed this to be faster than the bus to which it attaches, so that there's no kind of saturation strategy which would get you an unfair access to the to the data. In this one, you can saturate it because it's physically slower than the bus. So, and then somebody came up with a covert channel attack. So the reason we made it fast, one, it was nice to serve some applications, but there's a very limited set of applications that require it to be that fast. But the mitigation of various things, side channels, covert channels, things like that, fair sharing, meant that we needed it to be fast for those reasons. So let's move on. Surface area. This is a, we published this paper maybe 2 years ago. We're using a Baracchin-Pagliazzo-Wigderson extractor. It's a three-input extractor. It has three entropy sources. These inputs are supposed to be independent. These look independent, but we didn't want to bank on it completely, so we did some extra stuff to ensure decorrelation. And we extract and we output. This total circuit is 1,000 square microns in 14 nanometer logic. The fast server entropy, random number generator, the one with lots of AES engines in, is over a million gates and is 30 times bigger than this. This is a very small entropy source and extractor. We don't have a performance requirement, so there's no PRNG. We're just giving you full entropy output for whatever definition of full entropy you like. And the BIW algorithm is you compute A times B plus C in a Galois field, which is very cheap to implement in hardware. This is the same health test that I described earlier. That's also fairly small because it's computed serially. So this is our IoT, resource constrained solution, RNG. It is the, at the time of the publication, I don't know if I've seen anything to contradict it, the most bits per second per unit area of silicon of any random number generator. It's also the lowest joules per bit of any random number generator. So it's a pretty efficient thing. Let's say you're trying to get full entropy data and you're trying to be NIST compliant, you're going to have to add a DRBG, because they say so for the what's called the XOR construction ENRBG. So now these two blocks are to size. These ones, ignore these ones, they're not to size. This is this, right? This whole thing here is this, getting full entropy out, feeding it in as a seed and another value as a full entropy value, XORing them together. This is the output here. Suddenly you've got 30 to 100K gates, depending on your performance. And oh, look, 20 to 50X the surface area, 20 to 50% X the failure rate. So the this procedure that NIST put in nominally to improve the reliability of the random number generator doesn't really give you it. So this is one of the challenges we have, is the standards that are out there are not rational from a design point of view. We will put this into contexts where we need secure random numbers, but we don't need NIST compliance, FIPS compliance, that kind of thing. This can be used in a FIPS compliant design if you do the post-processing algorithms and software, but not, it's not a self-contained hardware solution that's FIPS compliant. So this is the quandary we're in. Entropy extractors, do you want them compliant or do you want them small? If we look at the SB800-90B draft, now B covers the entropy extractors in the NIST spec, the same one that had the dual, the ECDIBG and other things. That was A. B covers extractors. And C, the last of them, covers how you compose those two into a system. They list the von Neumann whitener as an extractor that's approved. That doesn't even work as an extractor, right? It's, if you have serial correlation from entropy source, von Neumann whitener doesn't work. is it even an extractor? I have seen no paper that says it is. It's an unbiaser. It does that very well.
So a
von Neumann extractor, you take the serial data. If you have and you split the data into pairs of bits. If the pair is 1, 0, you put a 1. If it's 0, 1, you put a 0. If it's 1, 1, or 0, 0, you throw it away.
It works for independently distributed identical.
Yes, so which is would be nice if they existed in this universe, but they don't. So you're guaranteed to have an even number of positive and negative transitions over a period of time. That's why it unbiases.
Assuming independence is unbiased, but that's all. Do you really have to assume independence? Why is it even in the standard? How did it get in?
Well, I don't know. I submitted comments saying take it out. I also submitted comments saying put CBC in. They did that, but they didn't take out von Neumann. All right, so we have the CBC MAC. But we don't have, as an option for compliance solutions, things like the Bracken-Pagliese-Wigginson extractor or the 2X'd, which is a quantum safe extractor, by the way. So these aren't options for compliant extractors. 2X'd, it's Dodis and friends published a paper in, I think, 2005 describing this. It's a two-input extractor. BIW is a three-input extractor. What makes this one interesting is because another paper was published, it's in the references, that said, oh, by the way, this one is a quantum safe extractor for entangled adversaries. So the result is resource-constrained solutions are smaller, faster, and more secure than FIPS-compliant solutions. It's just a fact of life when you're implementing these things. So we'll look at 2X'd. So this is this will make sense in a minute. This is, if you read the 2X paper, you'll see some equations that don't look like this. But if you work out what the matrix construction is, start with the identity, you take an element in a group, XOR it into this column, shift everything right, XOR in the element, shift everything to the right again, XOR the next value in the sequence, and so on. And you produce a series of fairly sparse matrices. These are the two inputs. So multiply by the input and do an inner product, multiply by the other input. And this forms a blender. And if we were to implement that in gates, this set of matrix multiplies dissolves down to this, which is an embarrassingly small circuit in digital logic. Compare it against the million gates for a fast server DRBG. You need to follow this. This is only the first half. You need to follow it with something like a Trevisan extractor. But this is an. I'm actively looking at this right now for post-quantum solutions. So I'm looking at various post-quantum solutions. But you find when you've got to make a concrete construction of this thing before you know whether it's. Whether it's implementable. And sometimes finding the concrete construction is not obvious from the way extractor papers are written. I'll get more on that later. Access models. So this is pertinent to the Linux discussion we just had in the previous talk. How do you access your RNG? And there's two basic models. There's a device model, and there's an unmanaged shared resource. So read-rand and read-seed is an unmanaged shared resource. Your user application, your library, your VM, all of those things can directly execute the instruction and get the random number from the hardware, independent of the operating system, independent of libraries, independent of device drivers. If you have some physical entropy source, that's not necessarily true if it's presented to the not through an instruction, but through a device. You need a device driver. There's privileged operation in the operating system to access it. And then the operating system needs to take the data from the device and present it to the system. Now I'm in a VM. The root bare metal operating system, the hypervisor, has access to this. But is it passing on actual entropy to the VMs? We may not know. We do for some VMs because we've looked, but but they're not all perfect. But generally, there's this device driver that's sharing that resource amongst all the users. But if you're a user in a VM, maybe you're not getting the entropy you're thinking you're getting. But a nice thing, the interactions with it don't need to be atomic. You can poll a register to see if there's data, then you can go and get the data. You can't, if you've got a shared resource, you can't do that because you get race hazards. So read rand, read seed, the random number generator we have in the Intel hardware, it's sitting on a bus. Your core executes an instruction, it goes over the bus, gets the random number, puts it in the register. So this is capable of injecting entropy directly into VMs or non-VMs, to libraries, to running application code. The operating system doesn't need to be involved, doesn't require OS privilege, but the hardware must prevent starvation, denial of service, core-to-core interactions, timing inference, and things like that. So for instance, when you read the random number over the bus, there's some atomic inline error reporting with that number. So when you get it, you know that you got it. You didn't get an error flag instead. If you're going to try and be a FIPS compliant solution, then for compliance, you need the FIPS boundary to be embedded in the random number generator. For this, you can make the whole FIPS boundary be the whole chip and do all those processes in the software. So this is more common in the solutions we do in resource constrained solutions, in big Intel CPUs. This is what we do. Take your pick. What's slightly unsatisfactory is Linux is kind of based on this model of, oh, there's these things out there and we'll be the arbiter of who gets to access this stuff and combining it. And the operating system doesn't necessarily know what the entropy is on its sources. So what might happen in the future? So this is more a list of what I think I'll be doing in the future. Quantum safe extractors are a pretty hot topic right now, not only because there's this supposed threat of quantum computers coming along, they won't, but there's the threats out there. So what do we need? Well, there's two completely independent, unrelated quantum things in RNGs. One is quantum RNGs, which is using events which are more like isolated quantum events to give you random numbers. But this is algorithms which are safe to quantum computer attacks, for instance. So quantum safe extractors are actually defined as being secure against entangled adversaries. So you imagine your adversary has some entangled state with the state of your entropy source. We assume the worst case entangled adversary and come up with an algorithm which is secure against it. So that's a really nice kind of proof for an extractor, because there is no quantum computer or adversary who is that well entangled with your state. So these are good things. 2x to the one we talked about earlier, that is one of those, and there's a paper that says why. For public key crypto in a post-quantum world, some algorithms, like ring learning with errors, require a Gaussian random number. I am skeptical as to whether we can directly build Gaussian random numbers that meet those requirements. You tend to take a uniform one and convert it.
There's a good deal of recent work that showed that you don't actually need Gaussian sources, that you can make do with.
Yes. Yeah, so I'll be deeply happy if ring learning with errors doesn't happen. Yeah. So it's a bit open and fuzzy right now what quantum computers what requirements will come out of that, but that's one of the scarier ones. Quantum safe PRNGs, this is safe against attacks against Grover. So generally that just means increasing the key size. But this is a big trend to smaller and lower power, what does that mean? Well, I described a small low power random number generator. Well, you can use it in a small low power chip, but in a big chip, what it means is you can have one of them at every point of use. I can have one in the crypto module, one in the fuse controller, one in each core. Because they're not big, nobody is upset when you take 1,000 square microns dotted around the chip. That's nothing compared to other things. So having small low power algorithms, RNGs, whatever, lets you spread those things through the infrastructure of the chip. If you want bus encryption on your internal buses, you need small, lightweight crypto algorithms. The problem is not what the protocol is. The problem is making these things small enough that you can put them in every bus endpoint. The same is true for RNGs. And then the other vector is bigger and faster. The demand on data centers for fast random number generators is there and growing. So this is what keeps me busy, working on these things. What time is it? Let's do the 10 minutes. Oh, that's good. Time for questions. All right, TTTP, time from theory to practice. Let's look at a couple of examples. Barak and Pagliaras and Wigdison published their paper in 2005. The micro-NRNG, the one I described earlier, was created in 2015, so the TTTP was 10 years. How did this happen? Well, there's this YouTube video. If you go to YouTube and search for On a Computational Theory of Randomness, you'll find this video, and you can watch it. And Avi Wigdison is describing to a lay audience extractor theory. It's quite an interesting talk. But in this case, at some point, he waved his hands and said, well, you can take the sunspots and the stock market movements and something else, and look, these are independent. And you multiply this by this and add this, and you've got a good enough random number for cryptography. And I was sitting there watching this and thinking, really? Is this true? First I've heard of it. So I hunted through his papers, and I found the paper, and I found he really meant do it in the Galois field. And he gave a different bound for binary fields. And I built it up, and I found, oh, well, this is a really small extractor. That's nice. And we created this, this small random number generator. The thing is, if I had read that paper, I wouldn't have known that. It wasn't obvious from the paper. I wouldn't have found the line. It was that he gave the hand-waving description. And if I go to Avi's website, I'll find about 200 papers, and I wouldn't know which one to look at. The CBC Mac, leftover hash lemma stuff was synthesized in, summarized and added to in the paper by Dodis and others in 2004. This is what we based the Intel DRNG's extraction off of. So we read this paper and said, aha, now we know what we need to do. But that happened went into silicon in 2011, so TTTP of 7 years. Why is this such a long time? This theory is important. This theory is what makes secure systems. Chip designers don't know number theory, and mathematicians don't design chips. And so these papers literally sit there for years until somebody who's close enough to practice can read it and say, well, actually, this looks like something that is implementable, that has good properties for implementation. And this has worked to inhibit moving from theory to practice. It would be on the engineer's side, maybe we should learn more number theory. On the crypto paper side, maybe we should be publishing more concrete constructions in the papers that describe the algorithms. If you think this algorithm is good from an implementation point of view, it would increase security, people should do it, publish a concrete construction, then engineers would understand it and say, I see this would be small, or I see this would be fast, or I see this would be good in some way. So that's my rant for my talk on this issue. It takes a long time to get theory to practice.
Yep.
Yeah.
Just hiring people who are in this room.
Yes.
Who will need jobs in a few years.
Absolutely.
Right, and I think it's becoming more scalable because we are a pyramid like almost any scientific discipline.
Mm-hmm.
So you've got a lot of employable individuals
yes.
at the bottom of the pyramid.
Right? Yeah.
And I don't see that
Yeah.
Just came out of, you know, studying extractors or what have you, right? Who is just trained to read those papers? That is their 7-year training.
Yeah. This is a valid complaint. I agree. If I had the power to hire more more cryptographers, I would. If I'm successful, I would be addressing some of your concerns, but I think I'm not. But yeah, so I think that's the end of my talk. These are references. There we go. So, questions? Are we all stunned into silence? All right.